London, training at the Martin School of Art, Royal College of Art, and University College London, right? I was one of the people we kind of modeled there, but became well known in art later on, called Goldsmith School of Art. So I was one of the people who went there in the early 70s. And I invented what became known as the theory in the studio. No longer separating what people think and what people do, but trying to make one thing into the other.
Is there any particular moment in architecture, history and practice that you most identify with? Or how do you think about the practice of architecture?
Well, architecture, yes. After art, in the 80s, I moved to the Architecture Association in London, which was the best known school at the time. So all the better known names nowadays came to the school, like the Harvey. When I was there, nobody knew who she was. Fadi, Van Gogh, everybody was in that school. Mm-hmm. I went there in 86.
You want to do a story on the images that you took of...
So I'm going to publish you in my magazine.
The MoMA.
Showing the magazine. It's called Footlash. He has a copy.
I got it in home. I took it home. I took all the valuable stuff home.
I'll bring you another one so you can
see
the deal.
What's it called?
It's called Footlash. You know, Footlash is a word used by North American Indians to describe their habits of giving each other huge presents. Sometimes suicidal. In other words, one tribe gives to the other more than they have in order to show that they are. So I called my magazine Footlash. It's about the gift in art and architecture.
No timetable,
you know. When we are ready, we go. But it's dedicated to the idea that, you know, that art and architecture ultimately is a gift, you know, because if you're doing something really good, nobody will compensate you for it. No matter. Most of you pay it good. It's without price. No? Sometimes people...
You have to make money, though. How do you...
Making money is a different story, you know.
Always.
So I have
people are doing fantastic things, also making money. Some people doing fantastic things, not making money.
Mm.
And some people making vast amount of money doing nothing worthwhile. I mean, there's two stories. They sometimes connect, sometimes intersect, sometimes nowhere near, and so on. No.
So I
you know what I mean.
He was getting ready to do something on the first architect, and I said, well, there's another architect, and that's the other guy that we photographed. Mm-hmm. So there was two major movers and shakers. They competed with each other.
Well, the most important man in these photos are Mr. Johnson, who was really not so great as an architect, but very much an impresario, you know, a kind of vehicle, like Miss Van der Weer, you know. Miss Van der Weer came to New York largely thanks to Johnson. Johnson himself was a nasty piece of work.
And how would you talk about the relationship between you and Philip Johnson?
It's complicated because without Johnson, you would not get a single feeling. And without me, Mr. Johnson would never design the glass house. But the glass house was a little bit a kind of imitation of this, you know. Miss was very unhappy there. The story is that he went there, he had dinner, he waited for the cognac and the coffee to arrive, and when everything arrived and he drank it, he left.
Imitation of me sounds fire,
Spanish.
Hey? Glass house with an imitation of me sounds fire. Inspired, Spanish.
I think inspired and imitation. And I think that if it was purely inspired, then Miss would appreciate it. But Miss did not appreciate that somebody like Johnson imitated him. I think the problem for Miss, I don't think, was the imitation. The problem for Miss was that that he had more respect for Johnson, and then he felt betrayed. Not by imitation, he couldn't be a lesson, because then he knew where it came from. The problem was humanly, you know, that he respected men, and yet that man is doing something not worth respecting. I think that's the story. I mean, I must say that I'm not a great student of Johnson, but I am a great student of Miss. I published a book about him. I was lucky enough that the book was sold for 15,000 copies. And you know why? Not because my wonderful text, which wasn't bad, but the publisher had this brilliant idea to hire a photographer, in fact two, one mainly, another one, and they traveled everywhere and they produced the entire Miss work as it was in 2000. So the book became bestseller, you know, I sold 15,000 copies. But stupidly, I didn't know it would be such a success.
You have more.
I find that I don't have any more.
It sounds like you don't.
You know, they're sold you know, they're sold on the internet for $350.
It'd probably be a good one to ask about the whole Philip Johnson, Edward Larrabee Bonds. Edward Larrabee Bonds, years ago, I was commissioned by the Museum of Modern Art to do portraits of all of the life trustees of the museum, of which Johnson
was
from the design and architecture program was another.
Right.
And in scheduling them, we had some difficulties. Because what I was told was that Bonds and Johnson could not be in the building at the same time.
Right.
What was that all about? Tell me. If you were, you probably knew. Just tell me. I know there was some history.
Thanks.
And
thanks. Johnson was very particular about his taste about men, younger men. He would turn the whole world around if it came to such things. That was one of his greatest weaknesses.
The way it is, simple as that.
You remember how Philip Johnson came in?
Whew, impeccable.
Johnson came in looking like $1 million. Like he just had a pair of $1,000 shoes that he just took out the pump. Impeccable. And then Edward Larrabee Bonds comes in.
He was like that. His father was a lawyer who kind of lawyer of rich this kind. So he was born in a very wealthy family.
But he got beat down.
The Bonds, did he do?
So he don't become
a building in New Haven.
You know, you don't become
a Columbus building in New Haven.
You are could be. I was never interested in his work, but you know, neither of them. But you know, if don't become a trustee of the MoMA unless you have a puppet. Eat that food.
And what is considered to be bond contribution to the field?
Minor.
Mm.
They have to have a lot of money. I mean, now there's this louder. I mean, he's a clown himself. He bought and collected a lot of money. His mother made the money. She created the cosmetics. You know, women always spend more money in cosmetics, even if they don't have anything else. You know, every time of economic difficulties, you think women spend less, they spend more. So if you invest in, I have a friend, mother, didn't have a lot of money, but the money she had, she bought only shares in cosmetics. She became a rich woman. She knew what women are like, so the woman has said. And she, whatever happened, women will spend on cosmetics. More and more. And that's how the other family, they started nothing. They started in the kitchen, not bigger than you.
Mm-hmm.
And she started making it and larger and larger and larger and more and more and more. And then they end up very important collector, but a stupid man, really nasty. I mean, I got to know him because once I wrote a text for a famous sculptor called Anthony Gormley, you know, makes this huge thing in London. And he had his first exhibition in Paris.
Mm.
And he asked me to write a text for the catalog, so I wrote the text, and he was a former student of mine.
Mm-hmm.
And asked for anybody for dinner. And who sits opposite me? Lauder himself. And the moment he discovered that I knew something about architecture, also, he wouldn't let me out of his thing, you know. He really wanted to know everything that I knew, which was impossible, of course, in my evening, but he worked on it. He wants to commission somebody to do something in the desert, who could do it, etc., etc. Anyhow, I got to know him pretty well. Subsequently, I wrote to him and he answered and thought about something. I wanted to get him involved in some project of mine. He then didn't. He's not such a great man. But he has a fabulous collection because he hired people who knew something about painting. I saw it. There was an exhibition of the collection in there,
mm-hmm.
in the museum that he built for himself, you know, the Neue Gallery up there. But it was upstairs, you know, there were paintings in the exhibition, and he couldn't see properly, because it was too small, the paint was too small, you know. You know, every photo of a painting, there is the correct distance from which you see it at best. And Sounds painting, that's where it's a large hole. You could not see them properly unless you went to the other room and through the door from an angle you saw them correctly. Can you imagine?
I don't know.
Other paintings were hanging in the corridor, you know, many paintings, not as many as this, but many, small works, but by a great master like Paul Klee. So again, you were too near, you couldn't see it in the corridor where they were hanging. That's louder.
Now he's run this whole institution.
Well, he has a maker, he doesn't run, but he, you know, he has almost there. Okay, he has enough money for it, that's all. And he has enough money so that people listen to him, but he's not a remarkable man. He's very unexceptional. What's exceptional about him that he uses money to create a very serious collection. Huh? Very uneven, there are people that are doing that, like medieval steel helmets and things like this, and you know, to use paint in the next job. How will it be said? That is written. So what I'm saying is that the MoMA largely run by people like him, you know. What can you do?